Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Mrinmay Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we'll discuss translation and India, and the module is on India and its neighbors in translational relation. Indian and its neighboring countries are actually connected since the ancient period of Indian history. These connections mostly happened with intellectual exchanges in different periods. One side, there were invasion of foreign powers in India. Some of them only invaded and snatched wealth from India, and some of them settled here. Ancient travelers like Fayyan, Huizenga, Itzing, Al-Masudi, Marco Polo, and Domenico Pais, etc., came from different countries, and travelers like Atish Dipankar went to China from India. Both the ways, intercultural connections happened between India and other countries. When foreign powers settled here as a ruler, naturally, cross-cultural contact zones were established. This cultural experience is translatable. This cultural experience needs to be translated, and whole issue of such kind of cultural encounter happens through translation. Though not always in the form of literal translation, but in a greater sense. Later, in the age of modernity and colonization, connections between India and its neighboring countries got more pace. India and Southeast Asia, especially Burma, India and China, India and Japan, all these connections again re-established in different ways, either as by product of colonialism or because of political and economic interest. A British colony was extended till Burma in the last half of the 19th century, and Indians were sent there for different purposes. Burma in the last half of the 19th century and Indians were sent there for different purposes. Indian Ocean, Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal were used for business purposes since the pre-colonial era, and it was increased during colonial rule. Hence, Indians were taken to Africa, to the Southeast Asian countries, to Mauritius Island and many other places, either to work as subordinate staffs or officers of British government, or as working class, labor class people. This is how a diaspora of Hindi-speaking people was built in Mauritius, and so many Indians were settled in Burma and other countries. Since the time of Hindu conquest over Burma, Indonesia, Maldives, etc., the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, Dhammapada and many other texts written in Sanskrit and Pali languages, and more specifically texts on Buddhism, spread over these countries. Later on, different Asian Studies Department or the Department of Indian Literature or India Studies established in neighboring countries, and study of Indian literature among with translation practices increased more and widely. Likewise, India also had departments like Southeast Asian Studies, Department of Chinese and Japanese, which are translating Indian literature into concerned languages, and vice versa. This is how translational relation among different Asian literatures happens and increased gradually. If we see our history of communication, we can communication with other countries in medieval period or even the very beginning of the medieval history of India, we can find that India had very good communication with the Arab world. The communication between India and Arab world actually created the path for translating literatures from India into Arabic and from Arabic into Indian. Sulaiman Nadvi's 1962 work, originally written in Urdu, titled Arab wa Hind ke Talukat, talks about Indo-Arab economic, social and cultural relations. Maqbul in 1969 wrote a book called Indo-Arab Relations with the Arab World from Ancient up to Modern Times. This book also shows Indo-Arab cultural and economic relation. These researches are necessary to understand the age-old historical relations between the countries. These historical accounts also gives hint about the relation of Indo-Arab literary exchanges. Translational relation between India and Arab countries is such an old practice that famous Indian text Panchatantra was translated into Arabic in 750 century by a Persian translator Abdullah ibn al-Mukaffa as Kalilaha wa Dimnaha. Before this translation, Panchatantra was translated into Middle Persian in 570 century by Borjua. Based on this translation, a Syriac translation was done as Kalilag and Damnag. Through these multiple translations and immense popularity of the text Panchatantra reached in Europe in 11th century, and it was translated into several European languages even before beginning of 17th century. Travel of this text proves there was an age-old history of traveling, business and their communication between India, Persia and other countries of the Middle East. But it is not only Indian Panchatantra which was received widely in the countries of Middle East and then in Europe. India also was influenced and received Arabian Nights, which is not only a popular text but translated and interpreted in different Indian languages many times. Spread of Islam in India carried Arabic knowledge along with the religion. The Quran was started to be translated into different Indian languages for the common people who did not have access to Arabic. This culture of translation of Arabic philosophy, literature and religious texts started since the medieval era of Indian literary history. Anthony Goland was most successful translator of Arabian Nights. With this English translation, the book got its life beyond the Islamic world. Apart from Galland, there were many more translators of Arabic literature from British India, like Frederick Rucket, Richard Barton from the Fort William College, Calcutta. Arabic literature departments, what have been introducing since the beginning of 20th century in India, gave more pace in translating literatures from Arabic into Indian languages and vice versa. Among modern Arabic authors, Naguib Mahfouz, who received Nobel Prize for Literature in 1988, is one among most popular and translated into Indian languages. India also had a very good cultural relation with Southeast Asian countries, as I mentioned earlier, and most of the popular receptions of Indian text were the text of the Ramayana, the Mahabharata and the other Buddhist text. There is immense and so deep reception of Indian text, tradition and culture in the Southeast Asia since the time of Hindu kingdom. The Ramayana as a grand narrative is spread over Indian culture and Indian literature since thousands of years, and innumerous texts have been created based on this grand narrative. We can find no less significance of the Ramayana story in the cultures of different countries in Southeast Asia than India. The Ramayana stories have been recreating in various forms of human expression in Southeast Asian countries like Bali, Cambodia, Malaysia, Myanmar, Indonesia and Java, etc. since end of 9th century. Different versions of stories are found which bring us new readings of the Ramayana. That Ramayana was already well known in Java by the end of the 9th century is evident from the magnificent series of reliefs carved into the walls of the temples of Prambanan in central Java around 900 AD. However, the first literary version in old Javanese, the Ramayana Kakawin, appears to date from a century later. It is based not directly on Valmiki's Ramayana but on a later Indian poetical version, the so-called Vartikavya, a Sanskrit poem written by Vatti in between 6th to 7th century, which proves that not only the Ramayana but also other Sanskrit texts used to be received regularly. This cultural relation shows a continuous cultural traveling between the countries and cultures. thousands years old shadow puppet theater of Java uses the Ramayana and the Mahabharata stories as themes of its narrative. The influence of Hindu culture and tradition gradually had been extended towards Bali from Java. As a result, we can find the Ramayana and the Mahabharata in many more artistic forms. The Malayala version of the Ramayana, Hikayat Seri Rama, is believed to have been committed to writing between the 13th and 15th centuries. One of the oldest Malay manuscripts in this country and probably the oldest known illuminated Malay manuscript, as attested to in media ranging from the great 7th century Ramayana stone pedestal in the Champ temple at Tra Kieu in Vietnam to the 20th century performances of the Seri Tera Seri Rama in the Wayang Siam shadow puppet theater of Kelantan and 21st century Indonesian comics, the Ramayana has retained its position as a literary classic in Southeast Asia through the centuries. Now you can see sculpture on the temple wall on the screen. This sculpture signifies the immense reception of the Ramayana stories in different artistic form of Southeast Asia. The abduction of Sita by Ravana is depicted on the stone wall in central Java, and it was made in 900th century. And the next picture also you can see on the screen. These two scenes are from the Balinese palm leaf manuscript of the Ramayana, written and illustrated by Ida Bagus Adiana of Jeria Gunung Sari Plaitan, Bali in 1975. Sita sees the golden deer and urges Rama to catch it. Ravana, in the guise of an old hermit, and Sita out of the safety of her magic circle. And all these photos are kept in British Library, London. And in these two photos, we can see that one is the recreation of the Ramayana story on the temple, on the wall of the temple, and another is recreation of the Ramayana story on palm leaf. So through this representation, we can understand that as Ramayana and the Mahabharata stories were received in India in different artistic forms, and it recreated through different artistic forms, almost same thing happened in Southeast Asia. So one is through the written tradition, one is through the performance, one is through the palm leaf, one is through the stone work on the walls of the temples. In modern times, though few in number, but we find translations of different Southeast Asian literature in different Indian languages. Literary text from Southeast Asia usually comes under the title of Asian literature, Asian children literature, Asian folk tales, etc. Thus, modern Burmese literature, Indonesian literature, and Vietnamese literature comes into India. The Vietnam War and urge to protest against imperialism also makes Indians to show extended solidarity to the Vietnamese. Vietnam War has even greater political significance in the international spectrum. War and whole narrative related or about war helps ex-colonies to imagine their third world identity. Vietnam helps India especially to release its anger towards imperialism, on imperialism, literally and culturally. Hence, Vietnamese poetry, stories, war narratives, letter of Ho Chi Minh, Ho Chi Minh's other writings also extensively translated into Indian languages. For example, many little magazines of Bengal published Vietnamese literature continuously during war. Even many books of translated literature from Vietnamese, and many little magazines also have published special issues on Vietnam after even three decades of the war happened. Now let us talk about India and East Asian countries and their translational relation. As I mentioned earlier, the East Asian countries like China had an age-old relation with India because of great reception of Buddhism in China. So many Buddhist literature from India and Nepal were brought into Chinese language. First Asian Nobel laureate Rabindranath Tagore visited China and wrote on China also. In modern era, Tagore was translated widely in Chinese languages, especially Indian literature or Hindi or Hindi India studies departments in different Chinese universities, especially in Beijing, took such projects of translating Indian literature into Chinese. After the Cultural Revolution in China, literature of Chinese peoples were literature of Communist Party, writings of Mao Zedong, writings of famous Chinese author Lu Xun were used to be translated into different Indian languages from the World Literature Center of Peking. Though such literature initially were translated from China, but later these books got their afterlife in Indian translation tradition. Tagore himself was very much fascinated with Japanese haiku. Later, this form was adopted by different Indian poets. Tagore translated few haikus while he was writing his travelogue, Japan Jatrir Potro, in 1919. Tagore was translated in a great number in Japanese language, either by the Japanese or by the Indians. Tagore and Okakura's friendship also brought a move in Indo-Japan translational relation. World-renowned Japanese novelist Haruki Murakami also is translated into several Indian languages, especially his famous Kafka on the Shore. A very recent translation of this novel into Bengali is published by Jadavpur University, translated by Abhijit Mukherjee. Along with creative literatures, we find dictionaries in Indian and East Asian languages, which also can be considered as very translational relation. Sahitya Academy has published Tibetan Hindi Dictionary in two volumes, compiled by Rahul Shankritayan, Suniti Pathak, translated selected poems of Tagore into Tibetan, titled as Sanyam Naga Vaduzpa. National Book Trust also finds Asian literature should be translated and there should be representation of Asia between two covers for the Indian readers to imagine the Asia. It published Together in Dramaland, which includes translation of text from China, Japan, Myanmar, Indonesia, Philippines, North Korea and Singapore, etc. Nepal and Sri Lanka also have a translational relation and literary exchanges with India. India and Nepal has quite interesting diplomatic understanding, and Nepal is not only a mere neighbor of India, but there was inseparable relation between these two countries in terms of language, literature, culture. One of the early Indian texts written in proto-modern Indian language found in the royal court of Nepal, which is known as Charyapada. This text is claimed as first text of Bengali, Hindi, Odia and Assamese as well. And other side, Nepali is an Indian language. Millions of Indians speak Nepali as their mother tongue. So the history of Nepali literature shares its experience from both the countries. There are two categories of Nepali text while we understand the history of Nepali literature. One is Nepali literature produced in Nepal and the second is Nepali literature produced in India. Sahitya Academy and National Book Trust publishes translation of quite a few Nepali texts into different Indian languages. There are many regional publishing houses who also have published Nepali literature into several other Indian languages. Sahitya Academy's contribution into Nepali translation of literatures, criticism and literary history from other languages is quite large. Such sharing experiences started from Buddhism to modern Indian literature, extend a different kind of cultural understanding and sympathy towards each other. Sri Lanka also has similar kind of cultural and historical relation with India since ancient time, since the time of the Ramayana, and later it was again enriched with the expansion of Buddhism. Sri Lanka produces its literature into Tamil, Pali and Sinhalese. National Book Trust published Mirrored Images, an anthology of Sri Lankan poetry edited by Rajiva Vijayasinghe, and The Bridging Connections, an anthology of Sri Lankan short stories by Rajiva Vijayasinghe. And if we would like to see the history of Pali literature and the Tamil literature, we have to consider the Sri Lankan literature and the literature produced in India also. So this is how, not only through the translation but through the history of original Tamil literature and Pali literature, both of these countries are related. Now let us talk about the translational relation among India, Pakistan and Bangladesh. This is quite interesting to discover, the translational relation among India, Bangladesh and Pakistan, as they were together before 1947. So these three countries do not share same history since last few decades. There are so many authors who cannot be claimed of any one countries or belong to two or three countries together. Most of the famous Bengali authors belong to both Indian and Bangladeshi Bengali literary tradition. There are Urdu writers like Sadat Hasan Manto, Altaf Fatima, who belong to Indian Urdu and Pakistani Urdu both. To discover the translational relation between India, Bangladesh and Pakistan, we need to survey the post-independent literary history of these three countries. Bangladesh is a single language dominated country and Bengali is dominating language for literary production, publication and circulation. But in case of Pakistan, there are quite a few languages which have literary history of long time. Urdu, Punjabi, Pashto, Sindhi, Baluchi, Saraiki, Kashmiri, all these languages are spoken in Pakistan. So by the very nature of origin of both the countries, as separated from each other, is again linked with the linguistic traditions. If we want to read a greater history of Punjabi or Urdu or Sindhi or Kashmiri literature, we have to consider the literature from both the countries. Translational relation in this case is actually the case of looking original again and back. Bangladesh regularly publishes translation from different literary and non-literary texts from different world and Indian languages. Famous and canonical and non-literary text from India also has been translated from English to Bangla in Bangladesh, like Gandhi, Nehru, Ambedkar, Maulana Azad, and literary texts like Anita Desai, Kiran Desai, Amitabh Ghosh, Jhumpa Lahiri, Arundhuti Rai, Aurobindo Adiga, and many more. We find a very less number of literature translated in any of the Indian languages from Afghanistan. Though there are so many representations of Afghans in different Indian literatures, but literary translation is too few. It is very recent phenomena that different novels written by Khaled Hussain has translated into different Indian languages. Such kind of experience shows that though many countries stay as neighbors, many languages stay as neighbors, but we do not consider all of those areas as literary areas or cultural zones. We popularly know them in some other identity. To build the translational relation among India and its neighboring countries, Sahitya Academy and National Book Trust has an immense role to play. Sahitya Academy and National Book Trust, these two government-sponsored publication houses, have immense contribution to build cultural relations between India and other Asian countries. Initiatives of these houses mainly try to build a Pan-Asian identity and take project to understand Asian mind through literary relations. Along with Asian identity, translations of different Asian literatures also help to understand so-called third world history. National Book Trust had quite important and interesting project along with UNESCO, what had a vision to build Asia-Pacific cultural relation through literary exchanges. National Book Trust writes about their Asia-Pacific co-publication program that this is a novel attempt under the aegis of UNESCO at developing books for Asian children by Asian authors to have children in Korea share their fantasies with their counterparts in Sri Lanka is probably no small achievement. And when Indian and Pakistani editors work as part of a team to build a list for children in the 20 odd countries of the continent we inhabit, it is a great new beginning. These books are steps for bridging minds and creating a common heritage for this vast continent and are the very best of Asia today. Such kind of literary, cultural and translational relation is no doubt offer a broader spectrum to have knowledge about different Asian literatures, which are less known or less explored. But it has greater significance too, which is in terms of peace and harmony among the communities staying together for long, long time in history. Sahitya Academy also publishes translation of literature from China and other countries of Asia or India's neighboring countries. Sahitya Academy once in 1980s focused on different traditions of the Ramayana and different variations of the Ramayana found in different Asian countries. Such kind of initiatives definitely help us to understand the cross-cultural histories of the countries and a greater readership of grand narrative. Now, let us conclude our discussion. India has observed more number of literature, philosophy, history, text to be translated from different European languages because of colonialism and expansion of European education in India. So the history of reception, influence of European literature in India is more strategic and structural. And such practices happened for quite a long time in India, very systematically. Naturally, such practices are hegemonic and culturally rooted, so we have been carrying the legacy, but India's connection with other Asian countries perhaps is not so systematic or so structural, and also it did not happen without any interruption. English literature or literature written in English is studied so widely in Indian academics that other areas of the world are not much explored by the Indians, or it is more or less same picture in other Asian countries. So it is very much hard to remember famous text from other Asian countries. Maybe whole Asia shares same kind of experience. This discussion shows that translation relation between India and its neighboring countries, not only history of exploring literary fields, but it is also a symbol other relations such as cultural, economic, political and so on. History of translational relation also unfolds the history of other relations mentioned above. Such kind of reading helps us to understand the life of literature beyond mere academics or institutional practice of literature. This history of influence, reception, and cross-cultural communication also helps to read the mind of the communities staying together or as never since a long time in the history. We must acknowledge that discussion of such kind, which is less practiced institutionally, definitely unfolds new world in front of practitioners and gives rebirth of forgotten or less remembered history of dialogues. Thank you.